perpetuating our condition as black people. We are making progress there. What does the DA do? Using again our black brothers and sisters, it has engineered this bout of black on black violence. Of course, our government has no conceptualization of the Pan-Africanist issue. Gigaba speaks about undocumented people. If Africans are undocumented, why don't you document them? What are you waiting for? Because your discourse is the same as the discourse of the DA that says our people are foreigners and are criminals. We say this understanding that there's crime in South Africa. People who come and do crime here in South Africa are doing their crime with their friends of South Africans. No one is doing crime, Jake. There are networks, there are Israeli networks, there are Russian networks, there are Italian mafia running amok here. There are even East African mafia running amok and shooting and doing this, but no one has called them criminals and criminalized the rest of the people. So, and in conclusion, just on this one, I think the Nigerian response is the most revolutionary response. You see, Nigerians are saying, okay, you South Africans are killing us there in South Africa. No problem. We're going to go to MTN. We're going to go to ShopRite Checkers. We're going to DSTV. You see, the Nigerians, in a very deep sense, understand what the problem is. The problem is such a white monopoly capital that is putting us to war with each other. So we must send a clear message to our brothers and sisters in Nigeria. We support your struggle. Ban these things of white people. Take them over so that here they respect all of us and they stop putting us into war with each other. It's a lesson to South Africa in terms of perspective. The Nigerians have it right. On this one, we must be one with the Nigerians. Our fight, I don't want to go on with this thing. We're fighting for cabbages and tomatoes and spaza shops and these kind of things. Malls are standing there. You go and fight black people for a spaza shop, yet you pass a mall. In Pretoria, I was there yesterday. White people's shops were open. You know, even in Sunnyside, white people's shops were open. It was black people's shops which were shut down. I think it's an important thing, and from where we're sitting as Black First, Land First, we're absolutely clear that no African is a foreigner. This problem is not our problem. It's a creation of, again, white capital and colonial project. Go to the borders. We did not create the border. We're walking around here up and down. By the way, black South Africans, we are actually the original Gweregweres. I hope you know this. We arrived now, not long ago, from Central Africa. Now, we have been doing the moving around all this time until white people put up those borders. And now you call yourself a South African and you say Mozambican is not your brother or sister. I'll stop there, but I think it is part of this conversation. How white supremacy or white racism organizes the troubles that black people find themselves in. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to be very pedantic about this. We have a bill, as you heard, is a BLF's own bill in response to the bill which is pronounced by our government, by Parliament. Parliament has published a bill claiming to deal with the problem of racism. It is called the Hate Crimes Bill. We read the bill and we know the bill has got serious problems. And we don't think that bill can be rescued. In fact, we then propose an alternative bill which will present to Parliament and representing the people of South Africa. These two brothers today will help, and you will help us to strengthen this bill. Strengthen the idea of how best we fight against racism. So this is part of the beginning of this conversation. We will probably have a few more conversations, not necessarily in Joburg, but in other spaces where we talk about how do we respond in this way to racism. Okay, why the bill? As we have said now, the full name of that bill is the Prevention and Combating of Hate Crimes and Hate Speech Bill, which was published last October. It is called a Hate Crimes Bill. Well, we argue that the Hate Crimes Bill has fundamental conceptual flaws, and also the remedies that it suggests are incapable of addressing racism. And we say that the provision of the Hate Crimes Bill are more likely to entrench racism, punish black people who are actually responding to racism. Now, this anti-racism bill is offered as a tool to educate and to agitate. Okay, now let us just go quickly through the aims of our bill, the BLF bill. First, we simply say to end racism, to provide definitions and also conceptualization of racism that does not harm the main victim of racism, which is black people. We also want to give effect to the state responsibility or obligations. I mean, the state here, I was thinking, you know, we are revolutionaries and Pan-Africans and black consciousness. We don't actually recognize this current project of 1994. So in your mind, when you talk, you must also think about the state you also imagine in the Azanian state. But we work within the what is available and expand it. And we'll talk a little bit about how far we want to expand it. Of course, then want to, the aim is to eradicate racism as indicated in the preamble. We'll go to the preamble just now. And to provide for amendment to the current constitution to bring it in line with how we understand what is needed to eradicate racism, and we give a context there. Continue with the aims, and this is very important. We'll discuss tonight a little bit the principle that needs to guide us if we're going to be successful in dealing with racism. And then this bill also provides for various offenses relating to the subject matter of this law, and also the prosecution of persons accused of such offenses. And then we also provide for sentences. Now, just to take some part of the preamble of the BLF anti-racism bill. The first point is very clear. Racism is a matter of life and death for black people. We underline that racism affects all black people, irrespective of age, of generation, gender, sexual orientation, political affiliation, language, educational level, geographic location, class position, and religious belief. We can have a conversation here, but we believe that it makes no difference whether you're Yoruba, you're Xhosa, or you imagine yourself to be Yoruba or Xhosa, or you are in the Caribbean, or you are in London, or you are, you know, in the US. In fact, it doesn't matter if you are president of the United States of America. If you're black, you suffer the same problem, and the world will treat you in the same way that treats all of us who are black. Now, we also say that blacks were given false solution in 1994. You know, the lie that the post-1994 democracy, the lie rests in denying the truth that white supremacy is materially expressed in land theft by whites, who of course took our land since 1652. We must underline this question again. White supremacy organizes all other contradictions. And then we continue. This point, I'll just raise this point as far as the preamble is concerned, this last point, that this law, our bill, recognizes its import or its significance as a transitional measure, because the end of racism is only possible in the final analysis when the institutional basis that make individual acts of racism possible have been eradicated. So long as we have not dealt with the actual root cause of racism, Penny Sparrow is going to be there and multiply. You're going to be shot saying that they mistake you for a warthog or a baboon. And so it will continue. You are corrupt by virtue of being black. We are already corrupt. We just need to find some evidence if we want to take you to court. But otherwise, we can just declare you corrupt. And that's how the bourgeois or white media will run with it. Go to the next. Now let's deal with quickly with some definitions which we provide in this bill. When we say black or black people, we mean those people who are by law or tradition politically, economically, and socially discriminated against as a group in South Africa. In terms of this definition, which was provided by Steve Biko, black people in South Africa are those who come from the African communities, the so-called colored communities, and the so-called Indians. We accept this definition of black. It's important, that definition of black, because you will see when we deal with the principles, who is excluded from being racist. Then racism, we adopt the standard definition of racism, which is about power, which really determines the place of black people in the world and benefits white people directly. Therefore, if you look at C, racist, following from that definition above, one can only be racist if he or she has the institutional power to subjugate or to maintain the subjugation. Therefore, black people are excluded from this definition. So black people already here cannot be defined as racist. White supremacy, again, is a global power of white people against black people. I think it's good to leave it at that. Here are the three principles that govern this bill. The return of the land is a precondition towards ending racism. Black people can't be racist. The anti-racism struggle itself must be led by black people. Let's just stay here with the principles. Let's just go to principle number one. In the context of the colony, the settler colony like ours, racism and white supremacy are organized principally by land dispossession. Whatever else that happens in society today, it's centrally located in the original sea, which is land disposition. Therefore, the addressing land is part, is a precondition to deal with this issue of racism. And we'll now discuss that in the next slide, but let's deal with quickly, blacks can be racist. Why blacks can be racist? If you don't adopt a principle that says blacks can be racist in a law that deals with racism, you're going to end up arresting and basically criminalizing black people. Already now, if you look at how the Equality Act is being applied, it's black people who are actually victims of this Equality Act. So what we need to win is accepting the principle that black people can't be racist. If you don't do that, this law is going to be a law, it's going to empower AfriForum. All of you who are on Facebook or Twitter saying anything about black or white people, AfriForum with its 300 lawyers and Kherinel will be there watching you. That court system is going to be very busy dealing with black people. And of course, we argue that this struggle must be led by us. Beautiful music. Now, there are two, when we have this conversation, we'll talk about, there are two interventions here. The first is, what do we do programmatically? What can we do programmatically? In some ways, things that we can do to undermine racism. There's a big question related to the symbolic power of racism, anti-black racism, which is a complicated a proposition. But there are some things that we can do to begin to undermine. One of those is precisely coming to the land question. What are we going to do about the land question? Section 25 of the Constitution is a big problem. And the bill of Black First, Land First says that that section must be amended. And it must be basically removed completely and must be replaced by the following. There must be an admission and recognition that all the land held by whites in South Africa is stolen property by law. To say all land in white hands is stolen property by law. Not some kind of howling of a guy from Potchefstroom. The law passed in parliament in Cape Town by people who are dressed in suits, sometimes in red. They must say land held by white people is stolen property. That is being truthful to a historical fact and recognizing the injustice of colonialism. Then number two, the primary purpose of the redistribution of land to black people or the black majority is for historical redress. Let us not even talk about what we're going to do with the land. What we're going to do with the land is our problem. We want it because it belongs to us. Some of us want it not because we want to use it at all, in fact. We just want the knowledge to know the land has returned. When I am there drinking cappuccino, I must know that our people have the land back. You know, now I drink cappuccino, but I know I'm landless. Even this cappuccino does not come from our land. It's a problem. So we want it for historical redress. See, all black people have a right to land in South Africa without any payment. So what are you asking? Even Cyril, our problem, he has a right to land also. Comrade Julius, you have a right to land. You don't have to buy it. The mothers, brothers and sisters in the townships, in the squatter camps, in the rural villages, farm workers, you have a right to land. So all of us have a right, an equal right to land as black people. And then we say the eviction of farm workers must be by law made illegal, and land occupation by the landless, by black people, should be seen as lawful and just. So when we live here, we decide, Johan Rupert, we have identified Johan Rupert's farm somewhere. All of us, we decide we want to go to that farm and occupy it. As black people, the law must allow us to do so. Because the law must accept that this land is stolen property, which is in white hand. So when we occupy that land, it means we are simply redressing. We are correcting an injustice. We are not doing anything wrong. Then there's a technical question of just have a department of land redistribution. You know, I don't know if you know now, if you go to this current department of land and rural development, they're doing food gardens, they're doing job creation, they're doing training. One thing they don't do is to redistribute land.
Mm.
So if you ask them, if you go to the medium term strategic framework, you know, those things that they write down. Every year government has a thing that's called every department. So you must have your targets. Do you know that South Africa, we have no targets to deliver land? So as we sit here, there's no document that says to us, this year, these are the number of hectares which are going to be transferred to black people.
Mm.
As a consequence, 23 years later, only 8% of the land has been bought back from white people, and we spend more than 50 billion rand doing so. If we continue like this, it will take us more than 100 years to simply buy back about 30% of the land. So we don't want, when we say, Comrade Hlaudu, you are a minister of land, we simply say, Comrade Hlaudu, we will judge you only on one thing and one thing alone. How many hectares have we given to black people? So that is, it must be by law. Then we are able to make some progress. Okay, there's some question of soil capacities. I think age is important to most people in this room here. This bill says the value of the mortgage or bonds must be adjusted to a value that excludes land in determining the house price, because land must be offered to you for free. So if you have your bond now, you go to look at your bond, you say, if they give you a bond of a million rand, you must go to NetBank and say, NetBank, okay, but what is the value of land in this thing? Oh, it is 300,000, thank you. So now I owe you 700,000, it's not a million.
Yes.
Because that 300,000 has been taken care of, land belongs to us.
Yes.
You just build on property that belongs to us. In fact, we can go further and say, for pain and suffering, we must reduce another 25%. So maybe I owe you 500,000. But even that, we can continue. For all the time you've evicted other people,
mm-hmm.
and taken their homes, black people, it's another 20. We know if we can run like this,
yeah.
we might all, the black middle-class housing problem will be solved. Because the problem is not houses. There's enough houses already around here. The problem is that these banks keep rotating us in these homes. I don't know how many houses I have bought and how many times they've kicked me out. So if some I buy a house, after some time I lose a job, they kick me out, they sell it to this one. You also, then Pravin comes with the interest rates at the Reserve Bank. Now you can no longer pay your mortgage. They take it, they give it to this one. You see, they're playing games with us. It's worse. We have another struggle. We have no time to talk about. Our comrades in Johannesburg are fighting serious evictions from banks. Banks are kicking our people out of what we call social housing. I mean, flats which have been subsidized by government money. There's banks involved and NGOs, but all of these things are white controlled, and they're kicking people out of their homes. I mean, as we speak now, more than 54 people have been kicked out in Jabulani flats. It's a fight that we are fighting. And when they kick you out, they come into your house with your children. They take your things, they throw them out, they lock and they seal. But our movement last week went to Jabulani and removed all those things that blocked our people from their houses. Then they welled. The revolutionary spirit of Black First, Land First, go and take away the thing that blocks access of people into their houses. That is why we support the proposition of being a constitutional delinquent. Okay, now there are some prohibitions here, the things that you can't do in terms of this law. If you do those things, are you going to be in trouble? Let's just move. I want to go to there's more of them. Okay, I want to deal with penalties. The government bill says that basically puts the penalties at five years and maybe 10 years. We say put them at, for attempted offenses. If Johan Rupert attempts, if he attempts to continue his project of excluding black people, if he just attempts, we must put him in jail for 5 years. But if we find him guilty, the minimum, we can put it up to 30 years. If he's a good judge, he must spend 10 years. And all the offenses of racism, and we have defined them, carry a minimum sentence of 20 years. Repeated offenders of any of the offenses will also have to go to jail for 20 years. Then we also make some proposals around education, public education. Because, as I said when we started, one of the problems we have in South Africa is that we don't understand what racism is. And I'm not talking about racist and beneficiary of racism. They don't need to know what racism is. It is us who need to understand what is this thing that is destroying our lives. So, and our children also might need to get a good sense of public education about racism, because it will also go into history. But also to assist our people right now with this battle we are having, killing each other. We don't know, for instance, as ordinary people, that the border which is there today was created in 1884. The borders in Africa were created in 1884 by white people dividing Africa to colonize it. It was not us who put up those borders. We don't know. Nigerian people, for instance, were spending millions of rands during apartheid supporting our struggle. I know this directly, because I know Obasanjo was involved with our comrades whom I knew went to Nigeria, and he gave them not just financial support, he gave them diplomatic passports. Our comrades were able, the June 16 generation was able to move around, and then he gave them a house. When they were back in South Africa, he came make sure they were fine. So, and all this was not his generosity. It was a state, a government response. You must hear in Ghana how school children were asked to go home and ask for donations from their parents to contribute to the South African liberation struggle. Now, we need to understand that. We need to understand how South Africans, because of Mozambique and Angola supporting us, how the apartheid government destroyed this Mozambique and Angola. In fact, in Mozambique, they lost their best son, Samora Machel, because he stood with us. That is their best son. They literally sacrificed their son, Samora Machel. So these are the things. This part of education will assist. It will not end, but it will assist, so that when this Afrophobic violence happened in Mamelodi, one or two people can stand up and say, wait, the problem here is not our brothers and sisters. The problem is elsewhere. Then we argue for special courts and also a media tribunal. I like this media tribunal story, because I just want that media tribunal to look after things like the Sunday Times. Just look at what the stories they write about black people, Million Guardian, and then call them to the tribunal to explain themselves.
Good.
In this way, they will start, you know, there's carte blanche here in terms of our white media. I mean, you must see, man, now our brother, Molefe, a brilliant, competent brother, sensitive, he even cries when he's under. But a very competent black person. Now he's in parliament. You know what they say? They say a Gupta appointee. There's no evidence whatsoever, but they write a headline like that. Because they need to destroy him so that he doesn't take over as a minister of finance. Mm. We are very clear on the other side. The black morality says Pravin must go. Brother Molefe must take over. He has proven that he can withstand the pressure of white capital and Brother Boniface is competent. But if you read white Twitter, white media, Rupert media, and you are a black person, you know you're going to hate Boniface. You sit in there, you say he's corrupt. You don't even know the half of the things that man has done. Because you, now that tribunal will be good because we'll call them to come and account. Why are you writing these things? Where is the evidence for the things that you write? So the media will be better disciplined and will stop. Then we call for an anti-racism barometer. So on an annual basis, we will have a report on what measures have been taken. Like now, we know Penny Sparrow and other individuals, the guy who shot us now, the guy who shot us another time, the person who was putting a black woman behind a cage and all this thing. But these are individual acts of racism. There are larger questions relating to the structure of the economy. What is the question of the transformation of the university? Many sectors of society, we should be able to be more, much more serious when we do that. We call for what we call the Anti-Racism Council, which should be equivalent to a Chapter 9 institution, which will have this Human Rights Commission. It's got nothing to do with racism. They're busy with many, many things, but not racism. They're unable to deal with racism. Their own legislation does not allow them to deal with racism. Their training and their perspectives will not allow them to deal with racism. So we'll have to bring in a new... Now, the last point is that in the bill, you'll not see this, but in the final bill, you will see this point, that we need the prohibition of racist organization. In other words, the bill must provide for the proscription or banning of existing racist organizations. So what DA, AWB, mm-hmm. AfriForum, mm-hmm. you know, so all of those explicitly racist organizations, they must be banned. And then we must not allow new racist organizations to be formed. Now, then we call for reparations. It is hereby established that a reparations process be undertaken to address the historical and contemporary injustice suffered by black people. Such a process shall be led by the same anti-racism council we mentioned. I mean, reparations is a strange thing that South Africa has not asked for reparations. If you look at Alexander and you look at Santen, you don't understand what historical racism and colonialism and apartheid has done. Santen continues as it was established at our expense. And Alexander remains as is. Now, this truth, this reality on the ground, is not going to be changed until we ask for reparations. When I meet white people, some of them, they shake their hand, by the way. They say, we understand what BLF does. One of them asked to take a picture with me the other day in Rosebank. I took the picture with him. I said to him, the condition for you to shake my hand and take a picture is that you need to accept that you must pay reparations. And this white man said, yes. I said, now you must go look at your assets, how much assets you have, and then now you must think to break your assets in the middle. Half of them must come to us, and then you can keep the other. You still live well. This white person was not very opposed to this idea. You know why? Because he's got so much assets that even if you give half away, he'll still live all right. So, reparations is not going to affect white people very negatively. But it's part of the discourse that we need to bring into discussing these issues. I had asked that there must be a last slide, and I'm not going to go there. But let me just say in conclusion, and I hope Brother Joja will also refer to this. When we explained that we're going to have this conversation, one of a brother who is in KwaZulu-Natal, Nkosinathi Ndaba Msenemu, who's trained as a philosopher, these guys, most of them do philosophy, he wrote to both of us an interesting SMS, myself and Joja, and he said to us, first, guys, are you really going to discuss the question of whether blacks can be racist? He said, I mean, this is an analytical question which is splitting hairs, really, because his point is, it seems to him, and I agree with him now, that explaining ourselves that we can't be racist, we are engaged in dialogue with our oppressors. We are explaining this to someone else. But we needed to explain this to someone else. 5 years ago, when we wrote the essay, Bless can't be racist. That essay was most radical and disruptive. Today, I'm not so sure, except that the principle of blacks can't be racist will assist in any legal process to deal with the question of, criminalizing racism. If you don't bring that principle, you're going to criminalize black people. But we are not explaining ourselves to white people. When I say to you, no, we are explaining this to ourselves. So the instruments that we design to deal with racism, we don't end up being victims again. That is the first point he raised. The last point that he raised was, and that's my conclusion, he said, what we need, he used a philosophical term of, we need a purposive political response. And he says, we as black people, we know the problem is racism, and that is a process of white people. What we do, what we need to do is to unite and to confront the problem. That is the solution. And I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you, National Convener. I think the most important point that comes through is for us to understand that no law that will address racism will be discussed without addressing the issue of land, without acknowledging that blacks cannot be racist and understanding why blacks cannot be racist, and that we as black people are the only people that are going to lead the struggle going forward. So I'll now hand over to Athi Joja, and he will give us his points.
Hello.
Hello.
I don't know what happened. Ndumiso Dladla ran away. Thank you for the invite. I made a serious blunder. I didn't know that we can actually have slides here. The last time we had a problem with a banner that was here, so I thought it was just going to be like, you know, we're hanging in a, you know, in a local meeting and we don't have technology and all those kind of things. So the line that I thought I was going to present might actually have some complications. It would have been nice if, you know, I'd realized that maybe put some images up to make it a little better. So, first I must say, I'm going to be talking with very, very eloquent people, and it kind of petrifies me a little bit. But they are my friends, so it's fine. I can make my mistakes, they will be there for me. And secondly, I must say, yes, I 100% agree with the bill. That is the BLF bill. It might appear to a lot of people that it's actually quite crazy to make all these kinds of demands, because our constitution is internationally recognized. Right. And we know when we say international, who we're talking to or talking about. But our inspiration has never, as Black radicals, been the international, whether it is the right international or even the left international. We've always had our own relation or our own creation of the international. So when I think about this bill, I'm actually thinking about the Haitian constitution at the same time, right? It was actually really crazy, more crazy than our bill, right? So yeah, but the route that I'm going to take, I'm probably going to read at some point and speak, and yeah, so bear with me. The route that I'm going to take is not going to be the legalistic one that generally just frames this discussion. I will limit my views rather on the cultural impacts and manifestations of racism in our society. That is the speech acts of anti-black racism. I mean, the reason why we're here now is because of those individual acts of racism, panis perro. And it is also quite important to look at those individual acts of racism, and how they're being reproduced today. However, these acts and habits are equally appear in the legal space, that is in the Constitution, and are enshrined in it as freedom of speech or of expression. They are, in essence, I mean, the freedom of speech, how I understand it, is a political legal construct. It is the political legal construct. As the law, as we know, the law is not neutral or natural. It is a regulatory means grounded concretely on political ideas of those in power. The law is the law of whites. The governing law, the international law, the international courts, these are white courts, and they work for white people. The law expresses and protects white interests, emotions, and even desires. There's an American thinker who once said, you should never take white people's feelings for granted because they turn into law. Yeah, so law is precisely an expression of white people's feelings and white people's interest. It guides them, it regulates our moves and their moves according to their interest. So I choose to place an emphasis on the political cultural relation and its racist logics. In essence, I'm interested in first what I call the structure or the system as fundamentally racist project, which depends on the law, culture. What I call the structure actually is that it is a combination of all these things that make white supremacy possible, which means culture, which means law, economics, and many other things, politics, and they are constitutive elements of the structure, of the paradigm of white supremacy. They reproduce it every day. More important and fundamental to the production and regeneration of racism is not so much its institutional or even individual capacities, how it manifests itself according to these individual acts of racism, but racism depends on this notion of structure. It is actually the name of this structure. Now, what is interesting is that we've always understood racism as something that is reproduced institutionally. And the logic of this institutional racism has been part of our daily vocabulary. And then when these big institutions are taken over by blacks, the logic of racism or our critique of racism disappears, because what we see in the institution is a black person. And we only associate or think about racism in relation to how that place is run by a white body, right? But I'm arguing that what is much more fundamental to racism, what actually is racism, what is white supremacy, it is the structure that is reproduced at every level of our society. Another provocative character by the name of Chinwezu once asked, why are we fixated with inequality when our condition of being is actually extermination? I am thinking of extermination as a condition of social death and many other deaths that black people experience under white supremacy. And if you're thinking around institutions and not necessarily structure, you're going to miss, and maybe the bill might even miss, the totality of white supremacy, how actually white supremacy dominates our lives. Racism as we know it is an incoherent, untenable emotional system, as I said. It is unexplainable. White people don't know how to explain it. So Bukwe tried, he was crying like, hey, but these people, science says this and this, you know, how can they doing these things? It's irrational. It's been so since racism landed here in 1652, and it continues to be so after 1994. However, as irrational as it is, racism is systemic, structural, and governed, penetrating every fiber of our existence. There's no place, part, time, where racism does not appear or regulate our lives as blacks, and even by extension, whites. When you're sleeping with your woman there, or when you are having, as you said, having cappuccino, racism is there. There is no break between life and racism. Every moment of our life in South Africa, it is a life fundamentally predicated and overdetermined by white supremacy. And I think if you think around racism in this kind of structural way, in the sense that there is no hierarchy between law, economy, production of images, culture, art, writing, white people swearing at you on the streets, and think about racism as a continuously produced project that can manifest itself even in places where we think it is not able to generate. Once Andile said, I think it was you, let me not really give you the attribute, but I think it was you who said, we had a meeting somewhere in West End, and it was a blacks only meeting. And we were so agile and heavy that we managed to kick out the white person, right? And the point was, comrades, don't be too excited, because white supremacy and whiteness is here even when it's not here. So there's no place where our lives are not mediated and penetrated by white supremacy. And again, did you put this with you? Yeah, so I'm thinking about this, I mean, the structure, what you call it, white supremacy, more or less in this kind of cultural way, or culture as this constitutive, part of the constitutive elements of white supremacy. I think it's Fanon who says, using Marxist language, later he gets supported by Fanon, by Biko, that fundamentally colonialism or racism is a complex relation between the superstructure, which is the cultural, the affective, and so forth, and the base. That white supremacy is first predicated on perverse assumptions that enable, justify, and maintain oppressions of blacks. Therefore, it is solely a white construction that gets reproduced over time and in different contexts. Under the veil of the Constitution, I mean, as Andile's critique, the Constitution, and I'm sure Ndumiso will probably touch on it. In any racist world, blacks appear with a questionable humanity, and whites a proper resolute one. Right? Now I'm coming to this thing of freedom of expression. I'm probably going to cut some things because I don't want to waste a lot of time. Rights to freedom of expression or speech as legal components of this racist structure, under these circumstances, this structure is an expression of those who have power and regulate it accordingly. That is, whites have a divine right to speak for and about themselves and others, the black oppressed. Under white supremacy, the law is a means to codify and monumentalize the values, norms, and rules of this racist structure. Black expression is outlawed. That is, it represents the abnormal and the intelligible. Demands that blacks make under the system are inaudible or coerced, or both. Or they are coerced because they are inaudible, or rather they're inaudible because they are coerced. Black claims and demands are impossible here and now. We can't make any claims. Cultural productions and expressions, the very act of social and human relationality, how people interact and are generally mediated by racism. You know, there's a book called with the characters in DCB, Mating Bird. And one of the reasons why Lusgosi found important to write about the book was that everybody else was writing about, you know, shooting this, shooting that. But what really, really interested him, where he found racism to be much more powerful and yet not quite expressed, was in the flesh-to-flesh relation between blacks and whites, right? And he tried to express this in his novel. And the fundamental point of that novel was that there is a structural block. It doesn't matter what black people do or don't do. The white system cannot hear them because their demands are impossible to be heard. In fact, black demands are actually inconsistent. There's a discontinuity between black and demanding, right? A slave doesn't demand. An African doesn't demand because they have basically nothing. They can't make demands. The white person then demands them to do stuff. They are the property, proper. As the bill states, racism finds the empirical and political possibility in how it has made blacks dispossessed subjects without land and therefore without control of where and who and what they are. The biggest paradox, of course, is that blacks are nevertheless free. This is what the Constitution says. That they are indeed legitimate subjects who have rights to speak and express their views. Right? We go to parliament, you know, we go to courts, we do these things. We are legal subjects according to South African Constitution. That is, yeah, they are legal subjects. But as we know, there's an inconsistency here between being called free, between being told that you have a right, and living a life of a person who's rightless, who's unfree, and a person who's basically a slave. I think it's Saul Plateau has that famous thing called a phrase or name called pariah, right? This is how we live in South Africa. From the president to that man who, the lawyer from the EFF and his white boy walked past. You know that man who was in the
industry? Yeah.
Dalim Pofu and Gareth Cliff. They remember the famous picture of them? I wanted to put it there. They walked past a man who was in a bin. So I'm saying there is a consistency in terms of how we appear to the law from the president, Jacob Zuma, to that man. There is absolutely no difference in how white supremacy treats us. We know from Shulosmos, right? Secondly, in line with the constitutional protection of our black rights specifically, this tension between rights talk and reality seems to not consider black demands, as I said, blah, blah, blah. When it says on one side it protects us and on the other side it doesn't, and that it, you know, the moment black people want to, you know, say something, in spite of the fact that they've been told they're free, you know, they checkmate it. Their freedom is null and void. There's no freedom. Black expression claims or demands are easily called racist, but from a black perspective, as Andile said, this is a conceptual, historical, and political fiction. Blacks cannot be racist. I'm thinking here of, and I would have loved to show these images, how white speech, how white critique, or rather critique as such, is always valorized, it is always taken serious, and it is always seen as such critique. And then in the visual field where I try to do some things and some writing about art and about culture, I mean, there are certain names, if you know Zapiro, how he's lauded. Brett Murray, remember the painting about the spear, how everybody else was talking about freedom of expression, blah, blah, blah. All of these artists are legitimate interlocutors, are legitimate critics who are fully protected by the Constitution. Because, as I said, they have, you know, their rights are discernible, blah, blah, blah. It does not end there, I argue. Just as we have seen after 1994, how the state power was used to maintain the status quo, something whites enjoyed, you know, and protected. The ANC was the darling of white people, because it reproduced its language and it reproduced the status quo. Artists like Ayanda Mabula, Zanele Moholi, have actually reproduced similar tropes and elements in their creative works and have been equally lauded by the racist system. Do you know, who knows Ayanda Mabula here? The guy who paints the penises of Jacob Zuma. Do you know Zanele Moholi? I mean, maybe people in the art world might know of a recent work now. Basically, what you have here, you have the structure of racism produced by white people as the norm, and as the paragon of critique. And then you have black artists who do exactly the same thing. In their minds, I'm thinking, like someone like Mabulu, who makes penises. But I mean, it's not even a painting, that thing. It's just, he makes a painting, but the focal point of the painting is the reproduction of the sexually thirsty, sex-thirsty, and savage Jacob Zuma. There is no participation in the critical plane via certain visual signifiers that symbolize a critique in a painting, right? What you have a penis as the quintessential referent and a signifier. If you black, you paint a black person with a penis, or like the judge who said, black men are just rapists, blah, 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 blah. Mm. That is enough to sustain the system. That is enough for us not to listen to you. That is enough for us to completely reject anything you can say, right? Because at the level of culture, at the level of object, the production of art, the production of music and culture, which actually works in our psyche, one needs these signifiers, one needs these details that underlie the structural logic. But in fact, what we see here, I'm just going to leave sort of, because I don't have the images, it would have been nice to keep on pointing to the Sholozi thing. But I don't have, so I'm going to quickly just so that I can say other things. In fact, what we see here is that black people's modes of expression are not only those that reproduce the status quo.
To speak is to properly secure the logic of racism. To be an artist, you must always, before you put your work there, you must always think, how white people are going to take this? And I tell you, this is something that penetrates every black artist or even intellectual. The reason why we cannot think or respond to white supremacy in a critical way, in the fashion of Bambaataa, in the fashion of Porco, in the fashion of BC, it is precisely because the structure makes it impossible, or rather it is impossible in the daily practices of white supremacy. So black artists eat their tongues. So coming now to perhaps this bill, if I'm, as I, maybe I didn't do this at the beginning, I would then think, what is the purpose, for example, of a bill like this? If we know that to take a legal vote, for example, one is already reifying the system, one is already operating on the side of the enemy. What does it mean to have a bill that we can take to Parliament and ask Parliament to recognize what is unrecognizable or what you cannot recognize? What does this mean? Is this consistent with how the system treats us? Can we really make demands? Is the bill really serious? Can we make demands in a situation where it's impossible for us to make demands in the system? So, what is the point? Is justice possible? Don't think so. But I also do think it is important politically. I do think it's important politically because I read the bill politically as opposed to conceptually, and how we try at all times to subvert, educate, and propagate and massify our political struggle. Trolls don't want to take this bill, or even Parliament, right? They might not, right? If we're thinking about the political situation through the lens of the ANC. But if our dearest father really means what he says, then of course, we're going to move. So it is important for political purposes. It is important to also show the limitations of our constitution. How our constitution rather reconstitutes white supremacy as opposed to obliterate it, right? And I think even that was point that we must stop this explanation and move towards a more purposive point is important and also quite questionable. It's important, but because, even if you talk about the essay, the point is, this bill allows for us to once again intervene politically and didactically. It has a educational purpose. Because people actually think the Constitution is the best Constitution, right? And they think all these things that we demand are made possible by the Constitution. But if you land less, but you have rights, all your rights are useless, right? So I would say what is fundamental in response to my friend now, is that one needs to be dialectical in a way, in the sense that you constantly have to explain. Constantly have to explain, and the bill is part of that explanation. Right? And you also have to be there, body and flesh, burning things, beating people, not each other, but, I mean, as he was moving, that we must actually do the beating. We must do the actual looting. We must be present in white people's spaces in such a way that there's a consistency between what we say and what we do. Mm. So, for me, to conclude, figure of speech or of expression that is enshrined in the Constitution is not for us. We must never move from a perspective that we can say things to white people because of the Constitution. We must move from a perspective that says we can say and do things precisely because of our historical situation, and also because we demand justice, and we want a real revolutionary situation to happen, not because of the Constitution. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Athi covered an aspect that we tend to overlook when looking into these matters, and looking at the cultural impacts and manifestation of into racism and society, how we can cry freedom of speech, we can you know, try to fight the system as much as we want. At the end of the day, the system is not meant and was not designed to serve the interests of blacks. The system is designed and is to advance and put white people in a position they want to find themselves in. They dictate where they want to be, what they want to say, how they want to say it. So things like culture, law, economics, and politics are only there not to serve us as black people. But we find ourselves having to operate within those structures of society. So, we understand racism as something that is produced institutionally, but it's like, if I can make an example of house, we are the people inside the house, and the house is the system. So it doesn't matter what we do inside the house, we still don't do anything to destroy or to even put a dent on the house itself. Mm-hmm. So can slaves really make demands? And how, if we are going to make demands, and yes, we are influencing and we are educating our people to ask the relevant questions, is it then the are we then moving on as constitutional delinquents? Is that a solution? Is the obliteration of the Constitution the solution to how we destroy the house? So I think that's how I more or less understood it. I'll now hand over to Ndumiso.
Well, I think I'm going to advance a position to the left of delinquency, which is abolitionism. The argument I'll try to advance is that it isn't a particular feature or features of the Constitution, but constitutionality in its present form that is the problem. And we need to obliterate the entire Constitution and not a particular aspect of it, because it is, to use Moseneke's terms recently, though in a way he didn't intend, the very scaffolding of white supremacy, within which all that is built will be consistent with this structure, you know. Before I get to talking, I think you know, I've already written a paper now during the speeches of the brothers. And, you know, the first part of this is the prehistory of the bill. I think it's important for us to note that the very proposal of the bill itself, not the BLF's bill, but the bill which is being responded to, betrays the very fact which has been denied since 1994, that South Africa is a white supremacist country. The fact that black people constituting the majority as they do need to produce a law in order to outlaw racism suggests that they do not, by definition, have the power to control their own social order. And so, rather than affirming the non-raciality contained in the foundations of the Constitution, it is precisely their negation. The prehistory of the Constitution and the Bill can be understood as the usurpation of the African National Congress from 1955. By some accounts, it may extend prior to that, but we can use the reading of 1955. 1955 represents a period in which intellectual sovereignty was surrendered. And so the imagination of liberation of the ANC, that's probably national intelligence. We see you. The imagination of the African National Congress was usurped. It became a white imagination. The Constitution is organically related. It's genetically related to the Freedom Charter of 1955. It took a long time for other African countries to reckon with 1955, but the judgment which was made by several African states, including one of the generals of Samora Machel, was the judgment which the Africanists had made, you know, after 1955, that as a result of this usurpation, the Congress had left the ranks of the liberation movement. It's described elsewhere by Motsuku Pekwa as having become a civil rights movement. It's an important conceptual distinction to make between liberation movement and civil rights movement. A civil rights movement recognizes the sovereignty and title to territory of the state in which it is present. It recognizes the outstanding issue of the withholding of particular rights from the populace of the country, but the legitimacy of the rulers and the title to territory is not questioned. So the objective of the struggle is simply for the people who are presently oppressed or have outstanding enjoyment of these rights to enjoy these rights, and then the problem is resolved. Now, if you look at the history of the struggle represented, for instance, by our friends, the liberals, they sought to fight for the right of blacks to vote from the very beginning. You know, certain historians of struggle history, like Jordan Ngubane in 1963 in his An African Explains Apartheid, suggests that the infection of the Congress movement with this petitionist sentiment and the willingness to convert the issue into a civil rights issue came through the education by some early predecessors of the Congress, by the liberals of Cape Town. That Dr. Philip, in his writing of petitions asking for better rights for the population in the Cape, inspired this as a method which the Congress would never be able to have leave its DNA. In any case, as I'm sure many people in the room understand, the controversy of 1955 is the conclusive claim South Africa belongs to all who live in it. This is, it's a violation even of the Western law's understanding. The lawyers amongst you will remember the Latin. I've forgotten mine, so I can't impress you. But the principle is, in law, wherever it is found, is that an injury cannot be converted into a right over the passage of time. Abantu described this as icala alboli, you know, in our law, extinctive prescription does not play any task. So the conversion of the white man's role from conqueror and enemy of the indigenous people who he had oppressed and dispossessed to a co-holder in the title to territory is an obfuscation of a historical dynamic that jumps from 1955 and continues until it finds expression in 1996. Now, 1996 is a great, it's a monumental deception, because even according to its own logical structure, the Constitution is fundamentally flawed and contradictory. In its founding provisions, it proposes that it is founded on the value of non-racialism. Let's assume for a minute that has any meaning at all. In Section 25, which the BLF Anti-Racism Bill takes issue with, the Constitution then fundamentalizes the right to property. Now, for the slower amongst you, this contradiction may not be apparent, but let's go through it. The problem is that the fundamentalization of the right to property, which until 1994 had been acquired precisely on a racial basis. Black people had been dispossessed precisely because they were black, precisely on racial reasoning. How could then the pronouncement be made the next day that the state was non-racial and protect that which was taken through unjust conquest? This is a contradiction in terms. So this contradiction is precisely what leads to the period which we find ourselves in. Now, this bill which is being proposed, the Prevention of Hate Speech and Hate Crimes Bill, it proceeds by ignoring the fundamental hate crime, the conquest of the indigenous people in the unjust wars of colonization. This is the first. It's the fundamental hate crime which gives rise and birth to all other hate crimes. If Nigerian philosopher, sociologist Oyeronke Oyewumi is to be believed, it was not only the invention of blacks, as Fanon teaches us, blacks were invented through conquest, through contact with whites. We were not blacks before they were whites. We were human beings. And this is what we are pretending to be now. We're pretending to be human beings. But precisely through the entrance of whites and the invention of us as blacks, and blacks is a signifier for absence, for the absence of land, for the absence of rights, of the right to property, of the right to use your language, black becomes precisely a negation of freedom. It's the other side of freedom. But not only were blacks invented by whites, according to some historians, women were invented at this time as well, because many of the indigenous languages and philosophies don't have a conceptual scheme in which gender is an ordering principle that entitles the human being as such to any status of elevation or in the division of labor. But the colonialists found this very problematic. So at the same time that they invented blacks, they then imposed their Western schema of patriarchy in the division of labor and rights within the social order according to this. So women chiefs were eliminated. Women doctors were eliminated. They became written out of history and the social order precisely to produce a schema that was governable according to the original logic of the conqueror. If our brother Zaytsen dies to be believed, even gays were invented as such, as an aberration of the social order, precisely through this pigmentocracy, the differentiation of people by the degree of proximity they have to whites in terms of their appearance was invented precisely by this. So all of the different antagonisms which are enumerated in this bill originate from one particular instance, which generates these various classes and categories that excite intersectionalists so much today. So the problem is that through the criminalization, I mean, the failure to criminalize the original injustice, the one true crime out of which all other crimes originate, is to sustain the original crime. And that is precisely what we have done. We have sustained the original crime, you know. We have given it life and effect. So the Constitution itself is laughable as any kind of emblem of a liberated people. In its hierarchization of the sources of law of South Africa, it places the law of the indigenous people, the law which speaks of amacala ngaboli, to the lowest possible status. Even the law of other nations, international law, has a higher status in the Constitution than the law of the Bantu-speaking people. This law is a law which can be undone even by magistrates who don't have law degrees. This is playing their games, but you know, the requirement to become a magistrate in South Africa for a long time didn't even require the patularis legum, you know. So even the lowest within the hierarchy of jurists in the Western tradition can overturn the laws and judgments made by indigenous people. This is the status that you have in a document that suggests that you are a liberated people. The law of your forebears is a nothing law that can be overturned by any whim. In any case, I mean, without going on too much, it interests me that one of the liberal lynch mobs had Negroes, Brother Makeza, wrote an essay called Ever Heard the One About Blacks Who Can Be Racist. It is quite generous to call this thing an essay. It's really an opinion piece. I just mean by the very structure and minimum conditions of an essay, it's not an essay as such. But let's call it an essay. In this essay, this brother suggests that even if one were to accept that blacks cannot be racist, I enumerate his criticisms in the book, so, you know, if you want to hear the complete version of this argument, I encourage you to invest in your future. But this brother suggests that, in fact, if we say that power is a precondition for the existence of real racism, that prejudice must be combined with power, then, for instance, there are some blacks who can be racist. This is according to him. So he has a hypothetical case, for instance, of the daughter of Tokyo Sekgwale at the time when Tokyo was still in with the big wigs of the party. That the daughter of Tokyo Sekgwale would have both the political and economic means, which black radicals are saying are necessary, and so some blacks, such as her, then could be racist. He also argues that by our own admission then, by the admission of the black radicals, some whites must not be able to be racist, since there are some poor whites who have neither political nor economic power. I mean, I believe this defect of reason is something which arises from the deficient training of this brother in analytic philosophy. It's not a fault of his own. The philosophy in which he is trained places no value on history. In fact, he makes that argument quite explicitly in the book. He concludes, therefore, a philosophically meaningful account of racism must dislocate racism from the history of racism. This, from a point of view of hermeneutics, is a ridiculous claim. It's a ridiculous claim. But in analytic philosophy, this is supposedly sustainable. Now, the problem, you know, so my claim, my critical claim is that whites not only enjoy economic and political power, and you know, they enjoy political power despite supposed minority in democratic politics because of the economic power. You know, laws are made, you know, for instance, the criminal justice system is famous in the Marxist critique to protect private property. Police show up faster in rich neighborhoods because there's more stuff to be stolen. The history of policing in South Africa is tied to the history of dispossession. There were no police before the conqueror entered our soil. They arrived with no soil, they arrived with no cattle. But suddenly there was a need for police to stop natives from stealing cattle. So the history of the police as an institution itself is the protection of property. Mm. Much like Brother Mekeza, they are not interested in the history of acquisition. Mm. So the problem now becomes that whites, in addition to political and economic power, also have what I'd like to call historical power. Historical power is a two-dimensional entity. It includes both the enjoyment by a group of power over a particular historical period. So the enjoyment and of successive enjoyment of power over historical time. But it also includes the enjoyment of power over history writing itself. The power over history writing itself. This is one of the ways in which the symbolic power originates. So if, for instance, Sister Zanele says to a white woman, you know, you are ugly. This may be a failing in interpersonal etiquette. But this claim cannot be racist in the same way that if she, the white woman, says to Sister Zanele, you are ugly. The claim which she makes has a historical basis. There have been treatises written at the University of Oxford on the inherent defects of the Bantu face, on the physiognomy of the Bantu, and its disproportionately large nose. The very cosmetics industry itself considers dark skin a disease to be cured. You know, so that claim, it has its basis in a historical and structural reality, which substantiates it. When she says you are ugly, she enforces the status quo which the world has already inscribed in its very fabric. When Sister Zanele, so even the daughter of Tokyo, whatever millions she has, cannot rewrite the history of people. She cannot enjoy historical power over successive generations to inculcate this reality into the fabric of the imagination of people. She cannot take over the cosmetics industry. She cannot rewrite history. She doesn't have historical power. No amount of money or votes can win historical power. It would require black people to conquer whites. It would require us as blacks to conquer white people and to impose our law upon them, to impose our language upon them, to make our lovely big noses the standard of beauty,
yes,
and to beat them into the belief that they were ugly before Sister Zanele's claim would have made it. So, in short and conclusion, I respect the rhetorical import that this challenge represents, but the fundamentality of the problem is such that the Constitution's own grammar becomes mired through the claims which are made here, because it requires the elevation of the indigenous law, the claim that the land should belong to the indigenous people and must be held in commune, is the restoration of the law that the Constitution itself subjugates. You must know, if you have studied the history of law, that Act 108 of 96 is not the first constitution in South Africa. Before this constitution, the Boer republics had a constitution, each of them, just as the British colonies. There was the 1961 Republican Constitution, the 1983 tricameral constitution. But all these constitutions of white people differ from us, from this one which they say is ours, in one fundamental way. None of them were supreme. Parliament in South Africa was always supreme when whites were in power.
they understood the idea of direct power to make decisions by parliament, which could effect change. But immediately, you know, the Bantu was supposed to be elevated to parliament. Parliament had to be nullified in its power to produce real unchecked change through the principle of constitutional supremacy, meaning that no matter how many of these Bantus there were, Joe Slovo would always hover, the white supervisor, would always hover to see whether or not their decisions were consistent with white reason. That is the only reason. Even white countries, which they try to emulate today, there are several of them. Great Britain has no constitutional supremacy. The idea that it's not consistent even with Western law to not have a supreme constitution is nonsense. They themselves, in their oldest polities, do not practice this. So why precisely here this principle at that time? Except, you know, that you know, there is a joke that my teacher makes, which apparently originates from the Boers, which says, Bantu, Trongtu, Parlamentu. That supposedly this fear of the banditi required Joe Slovo to make sure. But yeah, in effect, my claim is that justice itself is inconsistent with the Constitution.
Mm.
Justice makes the Constitution incomprehensible, meaningless. And so all those who are interested in justice really need to begin to direct themselves against the Constitution.
Mm.
Thank you.
We went deep tonight.
Yes.
We went very deep. I'm not even going to follow up on what Ndumiso said. I think it was clear. I think... Can we give our panelists a round of applause? Thank you. Before I open the floor, I'd like to give the panelists an opportunity to engage on what each panelist had to say. I'll start with the National Convener.
Thanks, and I mean, it is true, the two brothers have given us a lot to think about, but I just want to raise maybe two things, just to emphasize, and I think that the same point that the Georgia raises around the almost hegemonic nature of white supremacy that mandates, for instance, what is legitimate in the cultural sphere. I mean, you spoke about our brother Ayanda Mabulu. Ayanda Mabulu is my brother, by the way, he's my friend, and I meet him, and I know Ayanda's project in his mind, he believes he's doing something good for black people. But he is trapped in a whole discourse which is anti-black. So he ends up, in his mind, this thing is questioning radically. But in fact, it's affirming radically the white project. Which I think is a trap for almost all black people. Even our own bill, if you were to stretch a critique, you say, because your bill starts from recognizing a legal project, therefore you are somehow implicated in the possible reproduction of the problem. Now, we are aware of this. We are so aware of this, and this is where the conceptual and the programmatic somehow separates. You know, BLF said, hands off Jacob Zuma, economic liberation now. We have that campaign even now. A lot of black radicals don't get where we're going. But yesterday, Jacob Zuma, and he's been saying a lot of good things, yesterday, Jacob Zuma says, land expropriation without compensation. Now, if I say it or Julia says it, it means nothing. Now you have a head of state, the president of the country, who says, I want a law that says land expropriation without compensation. A lot of people, critics, particularly from the black consciousness and the Pan-Africanist tradition, will say, that's just rhetoric.
They don't understand what the rhetorical moves, what opportunities opens up.
Mm.
Before you do it, you say it, you imagine it. Once you legitimize this constitutional delinquency, we're coming closer to the proposition that has been made around abolition. Now, we're going to have to engage the president of the country. Firstly, we as BLF, we support Jacob Zuma 100% on this question. 100% were with him, Sholos. Now, we also say, Sholos, you see, whilst we amend the law, we must also occupy land at the same time. There's no contradiction between land expropriation without compensation and occupation of land now.
Mm.
Of course, it's going to frighten him and other politicians, right? As revolutionaries, it's our job to persist on breaking the constitution and insisting on land. Okay, see, like then my comrades from the ANC Youth League, we need to talk to them. I love them. I love them more than I love the PAC and Azapu people. Comrade Oros is able to go to the gates of APSA and say, if you don't pay back our money, we're coming back here and we're going to take this money. What more revolutionary statement can you make?
Mm.
Don't tell me about a critique. I want to see you confronting white capital directly. Because only then are you going to affect some change. So from this point of view, the Youth League is more, the Charterists are more revolutionary than our Pan-Africanist and Black Consciousness comrades who are not confronting white capital. Instead, criticizing us for confronting white capital.
Yeah.
They have de facto become agents of white capital.
Yeah.
Because they waste our time having us to talk to them instead of fighting white capital.
Yeah.
These reactionaries using Sobukwe and Bigo's name. Charterists are leading. It's a sad thing, Elizabeth Iskander. Now, I think what's going to happen, Brother Ndumiso, is this. Once the president of the country says, go and make a law that says land expropriation without compensation, parliament is going to fall flat.
Mm.
They're going to come back and say, we can't do this. He's going to say, but why? They're going to say, the constitution does not allow this. Then you must say, no, you must do it nevertheless. If we have a bit of majority in the same useless parliament, then we make the law, but then they'll take us to the constitutional court. And the constitutional court will strike it down. We are making progress, comrades, because once the constitutional court strikes it down, and we are mobilizing people on the ground, and we all agree we want land expropriation without compensation, it means now we must become proper constitutional delinquents. We then say, no,
this constitution,
this thing does not work, comrades. What works is our capacity to take back our land.
Mm.
Then we say, Comrade Zuma, remember actually, you know when they took land, there was no constitution, there was no two-third majority, there was no law, they just took the land. So Tina, say, as a passia corner, we know where we're going. Small. We are getting there. Ourselves, with all the constitutional delinquents led by Msholozi, we are getting there. But we must defeat the reactionaries as we move that direction. Another time, let me just say, and I'll stop there. We hope in April, we're going to invite Professor Ramose to come and speak precisely on the two questions you raised on the constitutional supremacy. This is the parliamentary sovereignty. Because that will start to drill into this problem. A lot of people don't understand that. Even when I stood up in parliament and I said, when I was still with those other guys who are now in London, when I said, ANC here is a 6%. You know, I had a meeting in the office with my comrades. And I said to them, do you know, even if we give them the 6%, they accept, we still have a problem.
Mm.
I went to the chapter 1 of the constitution and said, we're still going to deal with the constitutional principles, we're going to deal with the sovereignty of the parliament. And they were saying, no, let's talk about it. I said, I just want you to know what is happening. This is just one step. There's many more steps that must happen. Let me conclude by saying, Msholozi, this impresses me a lot.
You know, next week in Parliament, there's a debate on land, which the London Comrades has put on the table of Parliament. Yesterday, Mr. Rose says land expropriation without compensation.
Yeah.
He has checkmated everyone. Yeah. Next week, now people must respond to Mcholozi. Are they going for Mcholozi or not?
Yeah.
Because now we are no longer asking to Mcholozi and them to come. They are saying we are going. It is now for the other fellows to call London and say, look here, that man is saying he's doing the thing now.
Yeah.
What must we do?
Yeah. Yeah.
I will answer
it. I clearly.
No, I think what I wanted to say about someone like Anda is that, yes, I agree that in his mind, and many other artists actually who are against corruption, and this is only in the case of visual arts, one finds this in terms of music, one finds this in terms of a variety of cultural practices. But for me, I do think that as much as they're talking against corruption and all these other things, the central point remains the fact that it is quite easy for artists to express things that are aligned and consistent with white demands.
Mm.
As opposed to, if you think about the role of the artist as the one, as it's been always explained historically, the one who speaks the unspeakable, say the unsayable. The unsayable today, it is to point to the progressive critique and making available white supremacy as actually the criminal in the country. So for artists to evade, to completely escape that angle, to say those things, no matter how much they or we think they are morally inspired, what is fundamental to the cultural process and to what is expressible and what constitutes speech, it is how speech always already has to be consistent with white demands. Mm-hmm. So the fact that we think we're saying something and that we must be sympathetic to this and not be critical of it can also just be our mistake. I think artists, culturalists, and just people who have moral interest